today I'm going to tell you how to grow an eye on a frog's butt. I'm not saying you should do this, please don't. I am going to tell you how some scientists did grow an eye on a frog's butt. And the reason I'm going to talk about this experiment is because it's one small part of a much bigger set of developments that's now happening in biology. But as Herb intimated, first we have to talk about some particle physics, in particular the Standard Model, which is a little bit of a big ask for a Saturday morning at 10:30. But basically, Standard Model, most people think, when they hear Standard Model, they think of like the thing that you'd get at like the airline rental counter. It's just like, can I get an upgrade? No, sorry, we just have the Standard Model. And what it, of course, in reality, the Standard Model of particle physics is remarkable. It is the best and most tested model of how everything, the particles that make up every bit of matter in the universe and the forces that govern them. It's kind of like having a recipe list and an ingredients list for how to make anything in the universe anytime you need it. Biology really wants a standard model. But there is no standard model in biology. We've got the omes. You've probably heard of some of these. You've heard of the genome, the transcriptome, the proteome. And these have massively like advanced our understanding of how things work in biology. The only problem is that the omes, they're like separate continents that don't have internet connection or phone connectivity, right? They don't link up into a coherent whole. And so, and I think one of the most important parts of that is that they don't account for what I think is the most important force of all, which is electricity. So I'm not talking about the electricity you get to like charge your phone from a wall plug. I'm talking about the one that you make yourself in your cells. Now, the biologists in the room will know that every one of us has electricity thrumming through us every minute of the day. It's behind the fact that you can hear what I'm saying to you right now. It's the fact that I'm able to do this talk. And if you ever have heard of bioelectricity, it's probably because you had to study the nervous system in school. And in fact, the nervous system was the first place where it was considered even acceptable to talk about bioelectricity at all. So in the 18th century, at the end of the 18th century, we're just starting to get to grips with the larger phenomenon of electricity more broadly, right? And the anatomist, Luigi Galvani, and the inventor of the battery, Alessandro Volta, they get into a massive scientific spat. This starts when Galvani says that he's discovered electricity in a very unexpected place, nerves and muscles. And Volta is like, no, you didn't. And the resulting scientific war is so ferocious that it forces all the scientists in Europe to take sides. Now, most people take Volta's side because even though people keep finding evidence of bioelectricity in nerves and muscles for the next, 100 years, it's too weird, right? Like, why can't this nerve and muscle signal just be chemistry? Like, chemistry and biology, that makes sense together. Electricity is like for telegraphs or whatever, and we know what happens when electricity and biology meet. So people put it, they ignore it. But they can't really, because just chemistry can't account for the nerve signal, right? Chemical reactions are too slow to account for the fact that you can yank your hand away from a hot stove before you've even registered touching it. So it goes on this way, back and forth, and spatting and fighting until the 1970s, when finally the matter is put to rest with the invention of the patch clamp. Now, the patch clamp is a tool that lets us look into cells, well, at the surface of nerve cells, and we're able to see these little tiny holes in there, or observe, not see, but you can see these tiny holes, they're called ion channels, and coming out of these ion channels are electrical currents. And the electrical currents make it so that the nerve cells act a bit like a battery. They've got a negative voltage inside them, minus 70 millivolts. Now, finally, electricity is brought into the fold of biology, right? Settled science takes 200 years to clear Galvani's name, but we get there. This is great, all done, right? Done and dusted. Wrong. Because the next thing that happens is they take this patch clamp and they look at all the other cells, and oh my God, ion channels are everywhere. They're in skin cells, they're in bone cells, they're in stem cells, plant cells, fungi, microbes, like you name it in biology, if it's alive, it's got an ion channel. So why, right? Well, so you're made of about 40 trillion cells, let's say, give or take. And all the tissues in your body use different ions. And as a consequence, all the cells that make up those tissues have their own electrical identities. So we're looking at mature cells right now, down there, the fat cells, nerve cells. You remember I was saying nerve cells are about minus 70. Well, musculoskeletal tissue, that's more robust, it's minus 90. Fat cells, they're a little bit wobblier with like minus 50 or so. But that's the mature cells that make up the sort of, you know, the citizens that, you know, have the jobs in your body. Before those cells mature, when they're a fertilized egg, stem cell, they don't have a voltage. They're at zero. It's only when they hit their electrical, their physical identities, that their electrical identities go to these sort of robust electrics. What's even more interesting is that when those cells, those mature cells, decide to abandon ship and they become ravenous cancer cells that don't participate in the society of cells, well, they go zipping right back to zero. So now we start to have this idea that everything is electric, and that gives us the chance to start looking at some very long-standing mysteries that we haven't been able to solve. The first one of these is galvanotaxis. Right, so take a petri dish, put a cell in it, and put an electric field on it. Any cell will start physically crawling across the petri dish to the cathode end of the electric field. That is gross. And so even though scientists knew about it since the 1920s, they were like, no thanks, I don't wanna, like, I refuse to understand this. But now we're starting to get a little bit of a hint. The other mystery that this is starting to help us solve is the mystery of wound healing. How come when we get hurt, an injury, we scar over? But there are organisms that can regrow an entire limb after it gets chopped off. And for us, how come before the age of like between 7 and 11, if you lose the tip of your finger, it will regenerate perfectly, nail and all. And then we lose that ability after about 11. And there's the mystery of your shape. So how does a fertilized egg know how to turn into a human? So my eye color, hair color, height, that's determined by the genome. Those are the particulars, right? But what about the generalities? Like, how come we all have two arms and two legs broadly and like eyes in the front and like feet facing front, butt in the back? There's nothing about that in the genome. DNA doesn't contain spatial information. So how did this fertilized egg know how to assemble itself so consistently into this shape that all of us sitting here right now would recognize a standard issue human, chicken, fish, cat? We don't have like a weird long creepy ET finger. Nobody has like a gigantic ear. It's all really regulation issue. Well, after the patch clamp starts telling us a little bit about how to visualize our electrics, that's when we develop, after that, we start developing a whole suite of other tools. My favorite one is the vibrating probe. This is not what it sounds like. This is a, this is kind of like the patch clamp you can see on individual cells. This doesn't just tell you about like the action potentials on nerve cells. This tells you about the very subtle electric fields that emanate from all cells. And that starts to give us some solutions to this mystery of galvanotaxis, or at least a clue, because it's like, well, if all cells are electric, then of course it makes sense that they would interact with an electric field. The second thing is the dermacorder. So now instead of just looking at individual cells, you can see the electric fields coming off of entire tissues. So we have this thing, when we get cut, our body emits a wound current. It's big, and it's big enough, just like that, you know, the electric field on the petri dish, it drags all the helper and repair cells, like the fibroblasts and the macrophages, into the cathode of the biological electric field. That is the center of the wound. It's like a big red bullseye for all of them to congregate there. The voltage reporter dye is my favorite because that lets you actually visualize what happens as the cells assume the identities that they're going to assume. This is a developing tadpole, and they injected this voltage dye, which converts voltage into gradients of brightness that you can see with the naked eye. They were able to find, you see there's like a little mouth, a nose, there's one of the eyes, the jaw. This is a pre-pattern. This hasn't actually formed on the developing tadpole yet. It's almost like a premonition. It's like an electrical shadow saying this is where it's going to form. And sure enough, after a couple of hours, that's exactly where and how the physical features formed on this tadpole. But we don't just have tools now that can observe the electrics of the body. We have tools that are able to manipulate them. I can't get through all of these right now, but ion channel drugs are the ones that are the most interesting. So the patch clamp discovers the ion channels, and then immediately we get to work making drugs that can open these or pry them shut, sort of on command. And mostly they're used for nervous system disorders, but over the past 10 or 20 years, researchers have started using them for other things, mainly to try to edit this body pattern. And they've managed it. Here is a frog with an eye that was grown on its gut just by manipulating the electrics. Mike Levin, whose work is really instrumental in this, he took a worm, a planarian worm, that normally has just a head and a tail, and just by adjusting the electrics, he was able to make it form a head and another head instead of the tail. And here we go, as promised. This is an eye that was grown on a frog's butt. Now, it's really important to understand that this is not just done like for funsies. Like they're not just doing this, you know, for so that they can make weird animals. This is pretty serious because if you can start like working with bioelectricity, this has huge implications for wound healing, for regeneration, for regenerative medicine, and also for cancer. So, you know, the cancer voltage that goes back up to zero as healthy cells go cancerous. Well, there's a researcher called Brooke Chernay who took tadpoles that had been genetically engineered to express tumors, and by messing, just doing nothing else but messing with the electrics, he was able to prevent those tumors from forming by preventing the cells from depolarizing back to the zero state. He was also, and this is living tadpole embryos, and he was also able to take cancer cells that had already become cancerous and revert them to a healthy state just by messing with the electrics. So you can understand why people are starting to refer to the electrome. And you think like, oh, yeah, good, add a sixth one, go ahead. But actually, it is the power that the electrome seems to have to unite the others that is making bioelectricity research like potentially really, you know, paradigm shifting, I would say. So where's this gonna go? So let's go back to the 19th century, around this time in the 19th century, 1820s, the first electrometer is invented, right? We've got the battery or like a precursor to it knocking around. By the end of the 19th century, we've got streetlights in London. We've got the first telegraph connecting continents. We've got like the first power line. Electrolysis has added 50 new elements to the periodic table. And now, what about us? You know, it's 2023. We've got eyes on frogs' butts. and I don't think any of us want an eye on our butt, but like, what about eyes in the back of our head? Like, parents would be very happy with that. There is so much that becomes possible when, as it appears, we are programmable at the level of the cell. And so I guess I would just end this talk by saying we're only at the beginning, and welcome to the bioelectric century. And that's it. That's where we go.